So, welcome to Storage Wars. I will show you today the evolution of our storage. But first, to myself. As Tim said, I'm Achim, and I'm working as a systems engineer at Netways. And there I basically do hosting and infrastructure stuff. This begins with some kind of configuration management, some kind of networking, Cumulus, BGP, some kind of cloud platforms like OpenNebula or OpenStack. I'm at Netways, so I have to do something with Isinger and Isinger 2. And so maybe you get an idea what I'm doing all the day. In the last years, I have done a lot of storage. And as I said, I worked at Netways, and I worked for the managed services department of Netways. So we are 9 colleagues, and we do managed services. This means you can just give us your service, your web application, whatever, and we care about everything. We care about the hardware below, we care about the network, we care about local lanes, everything you want. But since you are a classic hoster, you can also just bring your hardware to us and just put it in our racks, and we will care about nothing then. So this is what managed service is doing at Netways. So, but today I want to talk about storage. And our storage changed in the last years. As I began at Netways in 2012, there was a proprietary solution. It was a NetApp, and it changed in the last years to an open source solution, Ceph. So I want to show you the way to our Ceph cluster, and I want to give you some hints to avoid pitfalls if you plan to migrate or if you plan to integrate a storage solution, open source storage solution on Ceph. And I want you to show our way from, not from my viewpoint, but I want you to show the evolution of our storage from the viewpoint of Tim. Tim is on the left side. Tim is a customer of Netways, and he just wants some virtual machines. He just wants maybe an NFS share, some database servers, a load balancing, and above all, he just wants a fair price for everything. So Tim sometimes is a developer, sometimes he is a more or less operations guy. So Tim knows about IT, but in the end, he don't want to handle all the storage stuff or the hardware stuff. And my story begins in 2012. And in 2012, Tim just wanted to know, it is winter 2012, he just wanted to know if his servers, his virtual machines, his share is always accessible. And yeah, for sure it was always accessible because we just had a plain NetApp setup. This means we had a disk array and a RAID for the integrity and for the redundancy of Tim's data. And the NetApp had two controllers, two heads. So if one head just fails, the other head can take over. And the virtual machines or the shares from Tim even didn't notice that anything went wrong. But Tim was not really happy with this because Tim knew that if his disk array burns down, if the disk array burns down or the whole data center burns down, he will lose his data. And at this point, as hoster, you can buy some new licenses. You can license for geo replication. That was the feature Tim wanted. And you can just buy new NetApps if Tim grows a visitator. And you have to, at the end, at hoster, you have to maybe double the price for Tim's data because the licenses for the proprietary storage solutions are really expensive. But this isn't what Tim wanted. He just wants a fair price for geo-replication and to run his virtual machines. And so the time passed by, and in the year 2013, Tim wanted for us to provide some open source solution, so he gets a fair price. And we just played around with different solutions, and we decided to try ClusterFS. Is anybody in the room who uses GlastFS in production? Okay, no, really nobody. It's not about because GlastFS is really bad or not bad. It's just I think it can work, but it didn't work for us. But let me tell you the story about our GlastFS. GlastFS had some basic features which we needed. There was a high available NFS share just on board. There was an integration to libvirt. So we had hypervisors with KVM on it. So integration for us was really important. And there is a self-healing daemon, a self-healing mechanism. That means if you have a hot failure, hot destroy failure, whatever, you just or GlastFS just heals itself and replicates its data on its own. So we decided to make a test setup. The test setup had six servers. It was a small test setup. Each server only had 10 hot disk drives, and each hot disk drive had 2 terabytes of data. So it was in 2013. We tested everything. We made failover tests, some stress tests, and yeah, it was quite okay. The self-healing daemon worked, more or less. We had some help from a core developer from India, and we thought we can handle this if we have a hardware failure. Everything will be fine, and we just can replicate the data. And so the GlastFS just ran for several months, and it was not a test setup anymore. It went over to a production setup, and it was stable for at least some months. And then we had a hardware failure, a big hardware failure. So we had the whole server just decided to go offline, and it was not a problem. The setup runs on, and everything was okay. But then in the morning, we decided to just enable the self-healing daemon, and the self-healing daemon just needed so much IOPS on the cluster. So the production IOPS or the clients who connected from Tim are not responsive anymore because the system, the whole GlastFS just was self-healing. And so, yeah, great, it worked. We had a self-healing daemon, and but during the time of self-healing, just the production of Tim is just offline. So at this time, we had to call Tim, and everything was not in a good situation. We built a quick workaround for Tim with a ZFS and a ZFS replication setup, just to that we can provide a setup to Tim with replication and everything. So, but for Hoster, this wasn't the solution to go on with all our other customers. So for me, the outcome of this GlastFS scenario was, if you test GlastFS or any other storage system, test at least with 80% of your maximum capacity. Why 80%? I have no idea. Just try to do your tests in a way your workload in the production will be. It's not possible in many cases, but maybe we had some better time with GlastFS if we did a better testing. So the time went on, and in winter 2013 and 2014, Tim was still a little bit angry, of course. And but we as Hoster, we want to go on. We needed a solution for a new storage because nobody wants to pay the licenses for the NetApp. And so we went to Tim and we said, okay, let's try Ceph. We already knew Ceph from an OSDC talk from Martin Löschwitz. And Ceph had some cool features like it was integrated to libvirt. It had a shared storage on board. The geo-replication, which Tim needs, was just on board. You just can scale out Ceph. That means if you grow, you just buy some new servers, and extend your storage. And one good thing was we could use the hardware of the ClusterFS disaster, so we even didn't have to buy new servers. But there was one little thing about Ceph we were afraid, and that was basically how Ceph itself works and distributes the data. If you write data to Ceph, you usually slice all your data in 4 MB slices. Basically, that's more or less correct for all ways you can use Ceph. But it's just the basic mechanism how Ceph distributes the data. So your data gets splitted in 4 MB slices, and then it's get written to the OSDs, to the hard disk drives. And in this example, we have, I don't know, 30 hard disk drives. And in Ceph, you have a process on top of each hard disk drive. It's called an object storage daemon. So each object storage daemon handles the data for one hard disk drive. And if you write the data to the Ceph cluster, you write the data to one object storage daemon. And the object storage daemon then replicates the data to other object storage daemons. In this case, we have 3 replica, and so the your data redundancy is quite good, and that happens to all your data. It gets written to an OSD, and it is replicated. And if you have not only 12 MBs of data, if you have 500 terabyte and you maybe have 400 of these hard disk drives and object storage daemons, and then if Ceph goes crazy, you can reassemble the data on your own. And that was the point we were really afraid of. But in the end, it never was a problem for us. So we tested everything. We built the cluster. Our first production cluster was in 2014. We started with a brand new Firefly release, and it was still the same slow cluster. It was 6 servers, 10 hard disks, which with 2 terabytes of spinning disks, and everything was fine at this moment. So, and especially for Tim, who asked for some kind of geo replication. It was a cool solution because Ceph replicates the data just to another DC without any additional feature. It's just how it works in the default. And if you remember all the OSDs, you can just build group of your OSDs. And the yellow hard disk drives are in the first data center, the blue hard disk drives are in the second data center, and the green in the third data center, or maybe another fire compartment. And if you want that your replicas get written to this different data centers, you just can use something that's called Crush. Crush is the basic algorithm. It's funny because I'm algorithm. so. You just have to add a rule, and you just can tell Ceph, okay, if somebody writes data to the cluster, send the replicas to the right data centers, and if one of the data center burns down, it's okay. It's not okay, but you haven't any lost data. but Tim was happy with this, but he asked what happens if he accidentally deletes all his volumes, his OBDs, and I just thought, why would you do this? But since we are humans, we are error-prone, and it can happen. And it's not a problem at all, because we already had a disaster recovery cluster. So we had a second Ceph cluster where we just copy all the data or the snapshots on a daily basis to another disaster recovery cluster. And I think Michael Robbe will talk about tomorrow in the morning about how you can run Ceph to Ceph backups. So if you're interested in disaster recovery with Ceph, just go to the talk tomorrow. So at this moment, Tim was happy, and we decided to migrate more and more virtual machines and NFS shares to our shiny new Ceph cluster. And in fall 2014, the cluster extended a little bit. There was more load on it. And Tim asked, or saw that his services were a little bit slowish. So he had some timeouts every night for 2 minutes. And this shouldn't be. And but for me, it wasn't a not a problem, because I already knew I can fix this, because I knew what we did in the night. We take snapshots of Tim's data and of all other customers, and that's not a problem. But we also delete these old snapshots. And if you delete the old snapshots, there's many input and output on your hard disk drives. And it is a good thing that you just can configure Ceph to avoid side effects to the client's input and output traffic. So if you do snapshots, maybe you will schedule the snapshots all over the night, and you set or tweak some configuration options that the impact to the client traffic is not so strong. The next thing what often happens and can produce slow requests in the in the production of Tim's clients is scrubbing. Scrubbing is a mechanism in Ceph to ensure that your data the integrity of your data. So once a week, all the data from Tim or any customer is just read in, and there's a hash. It gets hashed, and it gets compared with all the other clones. And if some clone is not in line, the clone just gets fixed. But you have many IOPS on the data, because you have to read in all the data once a week. And if you have some misconfiguration, it can happen that the scrubbing is not once a week, but it's every 2 weeks. And all scrubbing starts at a single time or in a single time slot, maybe between 2 and 4 in the evening. So the scrubbing can produce a high load on your hot disk drives. And the last thing to configure to which can produce slow requests on such a system is called backfilling. Backfilling is a mechanism if you, for example, have an error on your hot disk drive, your hot or whole server is broken. You just replace the server or the hot disk, and the data is replicated again. It's called backfilling, and during the backfilling, your hot disk drives are under high load. So just limit this backfilling, and for all three kinds of mechanism, you just have to limit this I/O intensive jobs. And to be honest, it's a good idea not only to limit these jobs, you should always limit your clients too. So with client, I mean some kind like Elasticsearch cluster, or maybe a Gnocchi cluster, or maybe a database which is doing really much work. And maybe it's also a good idea to just limit all of your virtual machines to an amount of IOPS you can handle. So maybe it depends on whatever your production is, or what your Ceph cluster can handle. But usually the customers or the products on the virtual machines just find a way how they can stress your cluster. So set limits. So the time went by, and we were quite happy with the cluster, and we started to migrate the last servers from Tim to the cluster. And one of the last servers was a MySQL slave, or a MySQL server with a slave. And Tim had the problem that the MySQL slave was far behind. And yeah, I just started to explain it's about the redundancy, you buy it with latency and blah, blah, blah. And the MySQL slave is a single-threaded IOPS thread, and Tim doesn't care about the explanation, he just wants us to fix this. So why we have a high latency on Ceph, or a higher latency than on NetApp? It's basically about the replication. So in Ceph, you write data over the network to the first OSD, the data gets replicated. It has to go through the network a second time. Then you have latency in the OSD code itself. Each data you write is processed by the OSD, and this adds latency too. And at the end, you have to write it to the spinning disk, or maybe you have solid state disk. It has to write it to the disk, and this produces latency too. So for us, a solution was we go with less density. Instead of 10 2 terabyte disks, we will use a 21 terabyte disk. So we just per server. So we just doubled the IOPS we have per server, and you have not so much density on a single hot disk drive. And this was a really good idea for us. It worked pretty well. And also the hardware price is almost the same. It doesn't really matter if you buy 10 1 terabyte disk, 21 terabyte disk, or 2 terabyte disk. And you have to think about this was in 2014. Now the prices are even better. And nowadays you maybe won't just make do less density. Maybe you just want to go to all flash because the SSDs are now affordable. And the endurance of the SSDs are quite good, so it's not a problem. So my hint here is, if you have, you get what you buy. So if you need a low latency, maybe you just should buy some solid state disk. If you have archive data, maybe spinning disks are okay for you. So once a while, it occurs that we just have to extend our cluster. And this often happens if Tim only needs more capacity and he starts only to write some additional data. And if Tim decides to write really much data, in a short while, I just began to cry because you want to avoid to have a full cluster. If your cluster runs full, you have two options how to handle it. You can get new hardware and extend your cluster. But if you need 2 weeks to get the new hardware, or maybe only 1 week, it may occur that your cluster is already full then, and you don't want this situation. The next alternative, what you can do if your cluster runs full, is you can try to lose data. In a production cluster, usually that's not really possible. But in our case, we could delete the snapshots. The snapshots are about 20 to 30% of our of the capacity, and we have the snapshots in the disaster recovery cluster too. So, if a customer needs the snapshots, we can get it from the disaster recovery cluster. And until the new hardware arrives, you just can delete the snapshots from time to time. But the better way is just to plan ahead. If you knew you need 2 weeks to get new hardware, you maybe want to set a watermark instead at 80% of the capacity. So if you reach the 80%, you just get a warning and you know, okay, I have to buy new servers because it needs time that my boss says okay, and it needs time that Thomas Quinn, in our case, delivers the hardware, but it's only about a few days. And so just plan ahead and set suitable thresholds. And then I met him at OSDC, I think it was in 2017 or 18, I'm not sure, maybe it was last year. And we drank one or two beer, and he wanted to know he wanted to know more details in Ceph, and he wanted to know what we already messed up or how we already messed up the Ceph cluster. And for me, it's really hard to find some points. Yes, we had some things like unsuitable hotbit configuration. That means our OSDs, our storage daemons, just get it kicked out of the cluster every 60 seconds, and they rejoined instantly. But it was not a problem at all. The clients, there was always a replica available for the client, and the IOP just went on. We had this situation during the maintenance after a major upgrade in Ceph, because the defaults of the heartbeat changed, and the clients just went on and nothing happened. You can, without any problems, just pull false slots on servers. You have to replace maybe a hot disk because it has some errors, or you know it will die in the next days. You just pull the hot disk drive, and maybe you just pull the wrong one because you're just silly and you can't count the slots, whatever. But it's not a problem for Ceph. It's you can just pull it back in again. Maybe you just rebuild the whole open storage daemon and the data gets replicated and everything is fine. So it's really hard to mess up your Ceph cluster if you care a little bit about your Ceph cluster. And when I say it's really hard, I mean it's really, really hard. And that's one of the next things in Ceph. It is not possible to just delete a whole pool. Yeah, I will not explain what the pool is, but it's really hard to delete a single component of Ceph because Ceph just cares about that you if you write any disaster request comments and press enter, he will ask you again and again, and it's not really possible to delete the whole pool just accidentally. So my last hint is. Go with the Ceph defaults. Usually the Ceph defaults are really good. And the guys, the developers of Ceph, care about a configuration that just works out of the box. And even if the time goes on and you don't buy hot disk drive anymore, Ceph will recognize your solid state disks and just set the correct settings for solid state disks. So if you care about the cluster, I think that Ceph will never let you down. If you care, if you just replace wrong hot disks and have a look from time to time to a cluster, you will be very happy with Ceph. And this was a very I have only 30 minutes for this talk, so this is just an overview about Ceph. So if you missed any details or you just want to talk about a little more about Ceph, just do it like Tim. Catch me at the beer, and we will talk about Ceph. So, cheers.
Thanks a lot, Achim. I think we still have a little bit of time left.
Yes.
Are there any questions to... Obviously, there are. Okay, I will just give you the microphone so we can get it on camera.
Just one small question. How are you handling placement groups in your Ceph cluster?
You have to decide, if you create a pool, how many placement groups a pool has. And you have to try to plan it advanced. So if you know you have a pool which will grow, which will double in the next years, you maybe want to save some placement groups for this pool. But if you know Sebastian Hahn, he's... nowadays he's I think a core developer or something like this, and he did some tests about the numbers of placement groups, if it is really a performance drawdown if you have too much placement groups. And in the blog post he has written it's not really a big thing if you have too much placement groups, but it's hard to calculate how much placement groups you want to have in a Ceph cluster. In our case we just began with a number which was which was in the documentation, and after some years we saw okay, one pool is growing and growing and the other pool is not growing, and we just doubled the placement group from time to time of the growing pool. That's we do, and that was never a problem to double them. And in the new releases you also can shrink the placement groups. It's possible now. I think it's since Nautilus it's possible.
Okay, I think this question got answered. Any other questions? Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Any problems during upgrades, for example, from Firefly to Hammer or so?
We had one problem in the upgrade from Hammer to Joule. I think it was. There was at the start when the USDs are starting with the new version, there was high IOPS on the hottest drives, and this needed some time. So the Ceph server, the OSD started with the new version of Ceph, and they needed about, I don't know, 2 minutes to peer to the cluster. And in this release, a peering state is not really good for your cluster because the client IOP is already getting to the new OSD, to the peering OSD, but the new OSD is not ready to serve the requests. And in new releases, this shouldn't be a problem because the peering and activating mechanism is redesigned a little bit. So if it's in this state, there are no client IOPs on this. And we did also an update from, what is this, from Ubuntu to a new version of Ubuntu, and you have the systemd daemon, and we had some problem that the systemd daemon scripts are not really good, so you stop the daemon and the systemd just starts the USD back again on, and that's a little bit of a problem, so you have to mask all your daemons, and if you're ready with the upgrade, you just unmask the systemd files and everything goes on. Oh, but that's the only things I can remember.
Yeah, okay, thanks.
Okay.
Hi. Did you have any problems with the new BlueStore memory defaults? Because there goes from 1 gigabit to 4 gigabit?
We didn't have the problem because we have enough memory in our system. But if you have many OSDs in one system, you maybe want to go with 128 gigabyte of RAM. In our case, we have 64. It's not a problem with 20 OSDs. Fingers crossed.
64 gigabit,
yeah.
Gigabytes, and only I think 12 OSDs.
Okay.
And then one node was down.
Just because there was no memory.
4 gigabyte, yeah, and that was too much.
Okay, and you just configured the BlueStore settings, or?
Yep.
Okay, good to know. at the moment, we have not migrated every OSD to BlueStore. We go with the file store and only go to BlueStore if the USD just gets replaced. And we have no problem with this until now. Maybe we run into the same problem if we have full BlueStore set up.
Okay, so essentially just throw money at Thomas Kren and the problem solves itself. Okay. Anyone else? Then I would say thanks again, Achim.